A 7.2 magnitude earthquake has rocked Darwin, forcing parts of the CBD to be evacuated. Let's go live to Kathleen Gazzola. Good afternoon, Kathleen. Has there been any damage?
At the moment, what we're hearing is mostly minor damage, mostly items being knocked off shelves during the earthquake itself. Earthquakes here aren't unusual given our proximity to Indonesia and the regular occurrence in the Banda Sea, but it was the size of this one that really caught people off guard. As you said, the 7.2 magnitude quake was recorded in the Banda Sea near Indonesia around noon, and then it started being felt here in Darwin about half an hour later. Workers here in the sea CBD in the high-rise buildings did report of really strong shaking feeling, computers being rocked, and they were actually quite scared with alarms going off that they did evacuate buildings here into the mall. Here's a little bit of what they had to say.
I think most of us were a little surprised and then realised that it wasn't just a big truck passing down the road, it was something a little more significant.
Computers were rattling and the door was shaking and, or, you know, banging against the wall.
I was a bit freaked out and I can still, like, slightly shaken a little bit, so it's not something you see every day.
There is reports of a family home about 20 minutes outside of Darwin in Palmerston that could have some cracks in their walls. But other than that, despite the severity of the earthquake, the Joint Australian Tsunami Warning Centre has said that there was no threat of tsunami to Australia.
Kathleen, thank you. Israel Folau's legal fundraising page has been removed by GoFundMe Australia. The website says it will issue refunds to all donors because the disgraced Wallaby Stars campaign breached its terms of service. Users are not able to raise money for legal defence that supports intolerance of any kind. The campaign had raised nearly $800,000 before it was removed. Folau planning to use the money in his legal fight against Rugby Australia. The Prime Minister has defended the secret operation to rescue the children of Australia's most notorious terrorist, Khalid Sharif, from a Syrian refugee camp. Let's go live to political reporter Jonathan Kersley. Good afternoon, Jonathan. The Prime Minister believes the government has done the right thing here.
He does, Amber. The Prime Minister says this is a sensitive and delicate situation, but it was his call to get 8 children out of the conflict zone. Nine News understands it will be weeks rather than months until the Sharif children are home. The 3 orphan siblings, Zainab, Hoda and Hamzi, were among 8 children rescued in an operation carried out in Syria late yesterday. Among the others rescued, Zainab's 2 children. She's 18 years old and heavily pregnant with her 3rd child. Her father was Khaled Sharif. He infamously posted pictures with another one of his children holding a severed head. That child has since died. The Sharif children have been reunited with their grandmother, Karen Nettleton, who's from Sydney, and Nine News understands all 8 children rescued are undergoing psychological assessments. They're also having DNA tests to prove they are who government authorities say they are. This was, though, a dilemma for the Prime Minister. Rescue the children from a war zone their parents took them to, at the same time making sure no Australians were harmed in the rescue and the children themselves would not pose a security risk back here. Prime Minister Scott Morrison spoke earlier today. Here's some of what he had to say.
Australians would equally expect the government to exercise all the care that is needed to ensure the security issues are well addressed in the decisions that we've made. And that's what we've done. The opportunity now is for these young children who are coming back to Australia. They can't be held responsible for the crimes of their parents. I mean, the fact that you would take a child and put them in a conflict zone like this is despicable. And I find it disgusting. But the children can't be held responsible for that.
Nine News has been told the Sharif children have undergone extensive security vetting. The other children rescued as part of this operation, they are orphans of Melbourne ISIS fighter Yasin Rizvic. The Prime Minister says he won't go into detail on that case out of respect to the family. As for the Sharif family, the children will return to Australia with their grandmother. The question is, how will they adjust? What support will they get? And how will the community respond? This, Amber, is a big test and the first of its kind for Australian authorities.
It sure is. Jonathan, thank you. More than a dozen people have been rescued from waters off central Queensland after a charter boat caught fire. Adam Hegarty joins us now. Adam, what happened?
Well, remember, three people have ended up in hospital and 11 others have walked away unscathed, which is remarkable when you take a look at this vision. This is the chartered fishing boat that caught fire with that family of 14 people on board. They were on a weekend fishing trip to a place called Masthead Island. They left on Friday afternoon. They were staying on that boat, anchored off that island. And then they were heading back a little bit before 9 o'clock this morning. They've got to about 20 to 25 kilometres off the Gladstone coast when that fire started. They've all tried to board a smaller tender boat to get away from that flames. They managed to do so, but that boat was far too small to carry the weight of all 14 people on board. That quickly began taking on water and eventually capsized. Then we're told by rescue crews that those 14 people were in the water for about an hour or more before water police arrived. Two rescue helicopters were also sent to the scene, one winching a man in his 70s to the Gladstone Hospital suffering from hypothermia and exhaustion. All 13 others made it back on another boat with the help of water police. Then two of those 13 were also taken to hospital, but again with relatively minor injuries, one with a minor chest injury and the other with smoke inhalation. Police gave an update a short time ago.
When the persons got into the dinghy started to take on water and it subsequently overturned, so all of the people were in the water. Luckily for them and luckily for us, the water police weren't far away.
Now, as for the cause of the fire, that is still being investigated.
Adam, thank you. There's no sign of an early end to the political debate over the government's income tax cuts, with Labor not backing the $158 billion package. Leader Anthony Albanese has offered a compromise. He wants the government to bring forward the second stage of tax cuts to help stimulate the economy. He's also urging the government to delay the final stage.
What we are doing is standing firm with regard to our position on stage three, but we're also saying very clearly that we are prepared to act in the national economic interest.
The Prime Minister says the government will be putting its tax plan in full to the Parliament when it resumes in just over a week. Australia's Ash Barty is the current queen of women's tennis, becoming world number one after she took out the Birmingham Classic in the UK. Nine Europe correspondent Amelia Adams has the details.
Well, it literally does not get any better than this. In world tennis, just 2 weeks after winning the French Open, Ashley Barty is now world number one after a convincing win here at Birmingham at the Nature Valley Classic, although it was her new world ranking rather than the trophy getting all the attention today, though Ashley Barty was typically humble about both. The match itself was a straight set victory. Things did get a little bit tense with her German opponent, Julia Gorgetz, in the second set, but Barty showed all the determination and composure that we saw a couple of weeks ago at Roland Garros to topple her 6-3, 7-5, and I caught up with her not long after her win. It hadn't quite sunk in yet, but she is now world number one.
It's just been a massive whirlwind over this last month, an incredible week here in Eastbourne, and I felt like that was probably some of my best tennis today. I knew it had to be against Jules, and really happy to have the trophy at the end.
Ashley Barty is now the first Australian woman to hold that number one spot since Yvonne Goolagong-Cawley in 1976. Her comeback all the more remarkable when you consider that she left tennis to play cricket only a couple of years ago. She only came back to this game that she loved so much 3 years ago, and now she is number one. The next stop for Ashley Barty is Wimbledon next week, and she is looking unstoppable.
A man has been crushed by a garbage truck in a horrible work accident in Sydney's west. The man, believed to be in his 50s, suffered severe head and chest injuries at Camellia. Emergency crews had to cut him free. He was taken to Westmead Hospital in a critical condition. There's more trouble for Sydney's Northern Beaches Hospital with a cancer patient having the wrong side of his bowel removed. The mistake is being blamed on the mishandling of pathology results. It is the latest in a series of dramas at the hospital, with a parliamentary inquiry into its operation starting in August.
This is a very concerning incident. We don't know where the cause of the mistake was, but our first thoughts go to the patient.
The government hasn't ruled out paying the man and his family compensation. King Street in Melbourne CBD has reopened more than 8 hours after a car slammed into a support beam on a city construction site, forcing its closure. The vehicle hit a support gantry for a crane just after 4 a.m, shifting the footing by around a metre. Engineers were called to assess the structure's strength and safety. The 23-year-old driver was uninjured. It was a night of record-breaking in Perth as Origin Game 2 went out west. Close to 60,000 fans packed Optus Stadium to see the Blues secure their biggest win in almost 20 years. Cameron Gock has the story.
A sea of sky blue and maroon filled Optus Stadium for WA's first ever State of Origin. A record crowd of 59,721 fans gathered in the west to watch a do-or-die match for New South Wales. And the Blues delivered.
Tom was underneath. No, he's got the ball, Tom! He's got another aerial Origin try!
As the rain pelted down, fans stuck it out. Not dampened by the weather, a vibrant stadium had fans cheering throughout the entire 80 minutes, including a happy Prime Minister. West Aussies attending to watch a different code of footy, which saw the Blues deliver their biggest win over the Maroons in nearly 20 years.
It's obviously very pleasing. You know, every time you score a try in this arena, you're pretty stoked. And yeah, to get through, I didn't have to work for them too much, but it was very pleasing.
We had a good turnout tonight, but there's nothing like running out in your home state full of Blues, so looking forward to it, yeah.
The state hopes this is just the first of many Origins to be held here as 15,000 people flew over, booking out hotels, filling up bars and pumping thousands of dollars into WA. And with both Scott Morrison and NRL chairman Peter Beattie calling last night a success, it's all the more likely we will see State of Origin back in Perth. But for now, all eyes turn to Game 3 for the decider in Sydney on July 10.